I want to introduce to my far right, it's Jacob Keogh. We call him Jake for UnitedHealthcare, today's stage winner. And to his left is Jeff Louder. Jeff, I'm assuming you got the Miller Lite Best Utah Rider jersey right now. That's what you're wearing. And of course, Jesper Stuyven. He races for the Bontrager Livestrong, and he got the most aggressive rider. He was one of the main protagonists in our breakaway. I guess I want to start with Jake, since you won the stage. Jake, I want to have full disclosure here. I want to say that when I saw you hit the deck, I actually said over the live commentary that I thought you would win the stage. What was going through your mind when you did crash? Besides, ouch. We already know that.
Yeah, well, I've gotten used to crashing this year. I've kind of had a bad run of it. But I was actually like kind of bummed out because my teammates were all riding the front, and I knew I had to get up and still give it a go. You know, I couldn't let these guys down. So that was pretty much my first thought.
Your first thought, and then your second thought when you crossed the finish line as the winner?
It was thanks to these guys. You know, they rode awesome. We committed all day, pretty much rode from the, you know, 5 minutes after the break went to the finish line we chased. So it was a real team effort, and I couldn't have won without these guys.
Help us understand, doing the live commentary, we got a great perspective of the race, but it always seemed like this. You know, Jesper was up the road with five other riders, and it was just this interesting dynamic. You would have extra G help, you would have competitive cyclists, you would have Garmin Sharp Barracuda. It was almost like you were, it was a big wrestling match, and you guys were tagging and getting out of the ring. I mean, give us a perspective from the winners. How did you see it being a protected rider?
Well, again, like I said, I mean, our team was the first to commit. We knew a lot of the teams riding for GC, and there's a couple hard stages the next 2 days, and we knew that everyone kind of wanted a bit of a break. And maybe even a lot of people were happy with a breakaway of stick. So we committed early. We knew we wanted a bunch sprint. You know, we started out with Ben Day, Chris Jones, and Phil Diamond riding. Jeff had to jump in halfway through and just start, you know, doing big turns. And then even in the last few K, Hilton Clark even did turns and wasn't there at the finish to do the sprint because he was still chasing the breakaway. It was a tailwind most of the day, so it was hard to bring back the time gap. And we kind of chipped away at it, and it was a last-minute catch, but good.
Thank you, Jake. And Jeff, Jake brings up a great point when he said, we noticed that the three riders, obviously, were doing the majority of the work and saving Förster, Hilton Clark, and Jake for the finish. You were kind of that middleman, right in the middle, and we noticed that once you started to get into the fracas of trying to pull back that breakaway, we knew things were getting serious. Was that the intent from Mike Tamayo and the team management?
I guess today you'd say I was the captain on the road, so I was trying to sort of keep those three motivated and also, you know, keep everything in check and try to, you know, think so that the sprinters didn't have to. And I knew, in, you know, in the back of my mind that, you know, once things got kind of dire that I was obviously going to have to jump in. And so it was just kind of that balance of keeping the break in check and then, you know, when it was time to, you know, just help them out. You know, it's a team effort to win a sprint.
So you readily admit that the situation was becoming dire because it was 45 seconds at 3 kilometers. Is that kind of what you guys were thinking?
Yeah, it was a nip and tuck, obviously. You know, it's always calculated, but these guys rode really, really smart. It was a really smart group of five riders, and that made it just that much harder to bring back because, there's a bit of a kind of a mind game when you're in the front. If you do race smart and think about what's happening, you know, you can kind of play with the peloton a little bit, and I think they did that to their advantage as best they could, and it left it to the end. But it's hard to hold off a group once they smell the finish line like that. So, you know, hats off to them for making it as close as they did. It was a really good effort.
Yeah, and now we're on to Jesper. You guys were in the breakaway right at about 7 or 8 miles into it. Was there any talking, or was it just all work?
I think the first 10K was working, but then we decided to take it easier. And then after the first speed zone, it was very windy, so yeah, we rode a little bit harder. And then we decided to go the last 30K full gas and try to stay away. And yeah, we almost did it. The stage was like 8 meters too long, but we tried it.
And Jesper brings up a great point. I don't know any of you guys that were fortunate enough to watch the Tour Tracker, but it was almost a yo-yo game. The peloton would bring them back to like 5 minutes, and then it would go back up to 8. So the peloton would drive fast, they would sit up, then they would drive fast, and the peloton would sit up. So it was kind of this unique dynamic. And Jesper, you said 30K left to go, you put your head down, and when you guys put your head down, you were fully committed. Was that super difficult? Because you looked like you guys were suffering. I mean, it was pretty hard there for a while.
Yeah, I think everyone was suffering at that point. It was a long day, a windy day. Yeah, but I think we were well together, like, till the very end, so we all wanted to try it. Yeah, I think everyone is very tired now.